Welcome, one and all, to tonight's Saturday Night Scares. I'm Kelly, a librarian at the Public Library of Youngstown and Mahoning County. Lock your windows and doors, and whatever you do, no matter how scared you get, do not scream. Tonight's scary story is called Whisper by Dr. von Puggenstein. Marcia wondered how she ended up here. She had moved to this town 6 months ago with her son Billy, hoping for a fresh start. The plan was to build a better life, surrounded by a group of friends that would feel like family. Now she and Billy stood among a group of people on a cold winter day in a small cemetery at the edge of town, listening as the preacher attempted to speak comforting words about the unspeakable tragedy that brought them all here. She examined the faces of the somber group. Most faces stared blankly ahead, while others wept, their tears mixing with the light rain falling gently around them. The preacher's voice faded into the background as Marcia focused instead on the rain pattering against the tombstones and the blustering wind. She contemplated how she didn't know any of these people 6 months ago. She could never have envisioned herself here, standing with them in the cold rain at a funeral service for a group of the town's children. A hiker who had wandered off the trail in the woods had stumbled on an unusual mound in a small clearing. She tripped while walking across it and thought at first she tripped over a tree root. A closer look revealed it was something else. She called the police, and further investigation identified the remains of numerous children from the town, some of whom had been missing for decades. Marcia didn't recognize most of the names, but as her eyes wandered over the crowd, she saw the parents of the one child's name that she did know, Tommy. Tommy had been the first boy that Billy brought over to play. She liked Tommy. Always full of life, you knew by the noise when he entered a room. It continued as long as he was there, leaving a startling but welcomed silence when he left. Marcia couldn't believe it the day Billy came home and told her that Tommy had gone missing. She tried to push out the thoughts of the horrific scene authorities uncovered as she watched Tommy's parents standing there, their faces numb and unresponsive. Tommy had gone missing a few weeks before the discovery, and in that time, the town itself seemed to also grow numb. Marcia noticed how the noisy, raucous streets were now silent, with passersby avoiding eye contact. Murphy's Grocery Mart, where Marcia had made the most progress in connecting with people, felt cold and distant. She would overhear a conversation in hushed tones an aisle over, but the conversation suddenly stopped when she passed by the aisle, and they stared awkwardly at her until she moved out of sight. It seemed as if the town was conspiring to keep a secret from Marcia, as though their lives depended on it. Billy had only made two close friends in their short time here, Tommy and Lindsay. Marcia noticed that even Lindsay's dad, George, had begun to act strangely around her. George, who was always so warm and welcoming to both Marcia and Billy, now seemed uncomfortable and tense around her, abruptly ending conversations as soon as he could. Upon hearing the discovery of the children's remains, Marcia was beginning to wonder how much of a surprise what they found really was for the town residents. The stirring of the people around her interrupted her thoughts, signaling that the service had ended. As Marcia grasped Billy's hand and started to walk toward their car, she saw George and Lindsay walking together a few feet away. Marcia felt like the town's treatment of her was somehow connected to these events and decided that now, with emotions flowing, may be her best opportunity to get George to tell her what was going on. She sidled up to George and spoke softly. "Hi, George, can we talk a moment?" George hadn't seen her coming over and shivered slightly when he saw her. "Oh, hi, Marcia," he said. The group stepped off to the side of the exiting crowd. "Hey, Lindsay, why don't you and Billy go play over there for a minute while Marcia and I talk? Don't go too far, though. Stay where I can see you. He turned back toward Marcia and continued stiffly. How is Billy doing? I know he is always so quiet. How is he holding up during this difficult time? Marcia locked eyes with him and held the look for a few seconds before George looked away. George, she finally spoke with a mixture of sadness and determination. We're good. Look, George, I know we are pretty new to this town, but something is going on here, and I don't understand what's all happening. People have been treating me differently since Tommy went missing, and they identified him among the group of kids they found. I'm really starting to feel afraid. Please, tell me what's going on. George looked around, and when he was satisfied no one else was around, he sighed deeply, and something inside him seemed to relax toward Marcia. Marcia, he began, this town, it has a secret. You mean the children? Marcia interrupted hesitantly. George answered just as quickly, no, yes, it's not what it seems. I think you deserve to know the truth for your sake and Billy's. Someone, something killed those children. But they'll catch him, right? Marcia interrupted again. George responded with a wave of his hand. I don't know how to say this, he spoke as he looked intently off in the distance. There's an old legend of a monster that has terrorized this town for generations. They call it Whisper. George fumbled over his words as he tried to make sense of what he was saying. Sometimes children in this town disappear and are never heard from again. This is the first time anyone has found any evidence of what happened. Whisper is responsible for all this. How do you know this? Marcia asked solemnly while trying to decide if she believed him. George looked back at Marcia and paused a few seconds before answering. Whisper spoke to me. He looked over to where Billy and Lindsay were playing just out of earshot. It said, Lindsay is next. It told me it was coming for Lindsay, and there was nothing I could do to stop it. At this, he broke down and began sobbing. Did you hear what it did to those children? To Tommy? I can't let that happen to Lindsay. Wait, Marcia interjected as she reached out to hug George to console him. This doesn't make any sense. How did this whisper tell you this? Can't the police trace the call? Why can't they find this guy? George stopped crying, moved Marcia back to arm's length, and stared solemnly at her. You don't understand. Whisper is not a person. I don't know what it is. When it speaks to you, it sounds like a whispering wind to everyone else. But you hear a voice speaking clearly and directly to you. No one has ever seen it. You just hear its voice. No one knows how this thing abducts the children, and it's never been stopped. I'd heard the stories about Whisper since I was a kid, but I never thought it would happen to... He stopped for a moment and looked from Marcia over to Lindsay. Lindsay, honey, it's time to go home. Say goodbye to Billy. Marcia, I'm sorry. I have to get Lindsay home. You might want to think about moving back to where you came from. I wish I'd left this cursed town a long time ago. Marcia and Billy walked slowly back to their car, and she explained that Billy probably wouldn't be seeing Lindsay for a little while, that he needed to be extra careful and not talk to any strangers. Billy stayed quiet and couldn't help but wonder if this had anything to do with the new friend Lindsay just told him about. She said she had told her dad about her new invisible friend, how he wanted to play with her, and how her dad said her new friend was a bad man and did not listen to him or go anywhere with him. Lindsay didn't understand why her dad said that. She thought her new friend sounded nice and wasn't bad at all. He just wanted to play. Billy opened his mouth to tell his mom, but then he remembered Lindsay had made him promise not to say anything. He wasn't sure that was the right thing to do, but he had promised her. He closed his mouth and instead listened as the soft wind began to swirl around him. Several days passed. His mom had been much more protective, making Billy come straight home after school and always seeming to have her eye on him. He had not seen Lindsay at school since the funeral and was just thinking about her when the doorbell rang. Marcia went to answer the door, advising Billy to stay back as the doorbell was followed up by pounding at the door and a distraught voice bellowing Marcia's name. Marcia opened the door and George brushed past her. "Is she here?" George sputtered and strode quickly through the house, looking about in every direction. "Is she here?" "Who?" Marcia answered, clutching Billy to her side and following George through the house. "Who are you talking about?" George stopped suddenly, turned, and looked directly at Marcia. "It's Lindsay. She's disappeared. Did she come here?" Looking down at Billy, he continued, "Have you seen her? Please tell me if you know anything." Before Billy could answer, a gust of wind blew open the front door, attracting the attention of all three. George looked at Marcia. Her face seemed to be glossed over. George recognized that look and reached out to grab her shoulder. "Is that Whisper? Is it talking to you? Whisper! Tell me where my daughter is!" The wind swirling through the door into the house was the only response he received, and Billy thought it sounded a little bit like laughter. The wind reversed and seemed to blow back out of the house. George frantically chased it, calling out as he exited, "Please let me know if you see or hear anything. I have to find her before..." Marcia promised she would as she slammed the door behind George. She looked at Billy, and all of the recent events flooded through her mind. A sense of dread fell over her when she thought about Lindsay and would have followed George out to help look for Lindsay if she could. But something held her back. Something she didn't tell George. The wind that the three of them heard had spoken to her, just like George had described at the cemetery. The voice spoke softly, but it was clear and distinct. She did not recognize the voice, but the words chilled her to the core. She didn't know how to tell George that the voice had said, "Lindsay is with me now, playing with Tommy. They're asking if Billy can come play too." Could it be she just thought that herself? But that voice was not hers. It had to be Whisper. She had just heard Whisper. Marcia sent Billy up to his room to play. She didn't want to frighten him, so she waited until he closed his bedroom door before frantically running through the rest of the house, locking all the windows and doors. Feeling a little bit safer, she relaxed, and the emotional toll of the day finally hit her. She was exhausted and thought some rest would help. She checked on Billy in his room and told him that she was going to take a short nap and not to leave the house or answer the door. Billy looked up at his mom. She seemed worried, though Billy couldn't understand why. He knew Lindsay was missing, but he was sure she was okay and would probably be found soon. He nodded in response and went back to playing with his cars as she left, closing his door behind her. Then Billy thought he heard her call his name again and turned back around to face the door. The door was still closed, and he looked around to see who called his name, but no one was there. He returned to playing when he, again, heard a faint whisper. "Billy!" He stopped playing and looked around. "Billy!" the voice spoke again, and this time he thought he recognized the voice. "It's me, Billy." "Lindsay?" he spoke softly. "Is that you? Are you okay?" "I'm okay," the voice responded. "I found a fun place to play. Tommy is here too, and I met some new friends." "Where are you?" Billy asked. "Everyone is looking for you." "Come play with me," the voice said. "It's fun here. You'll really like it." "I don't know," Billy replied. Your dad is really worried about you, and my mom said not to leave the house. Please, Billy, come play with me just for a little while. Then I'll go with you back to my house, and everything will be okay. But I don't know where you are. How do I find you? It's easy, the voice responded. I'll guide you. Just follow my voice, and I'll tell you where to go. I don't know, Billy said, though his voice betrayed that he was considering coming. My mom will be mad. You can't tell your mom or I can't come home. You want me to come home, don't you? The voice said, making one final push to convince him. Just come here to me. We'll play, and everyone will be happy when we come back. Then we can come here to play anytime we want. Meanwhile, Marcia tossed and turned in a fitful sleep on her bed. She dreamed that Billy stood just beyond her reach, and as she reached out for him, he disappeared while calling out, Marcia, to her. But he never called her by name. She woke with a start and again heard her name in a gentle whisper. She remembered the sinister voice that spoke to her earlier and called out shakily, What do you want? I need a new child to play with. Tommy and Lindsay were fun, but I think Billy wants to play too. No! She screamed, scrambling out of bed and dashing from her bedroom down the hall toward Billy's room. She thought, I'm sure he's still there playing. It's only been a little while, and I told him not to go anywhere. She reached Billy's room, threw open the door, and dashed inside. She looked down to find his car scattered across the floor, but no Billy. She frantically searched the room, calling out Billy's name. Finding it empty, she searched the rest of the house. She opened the front door and saw it had begun to snow outside. She looked all around, but didn't see Billy. She ran to the back door and scanned the backyard. Billy wasn't there. Marcia stood there in shock. She had no idea where Billy could be. He was gone. Somehow this whisper now had Billy. Despondent, she hung her head and then saw something that finally gave her hope. A single pair of small footprints in the snow leading out the door and away from the house. She put on the shoes next to the door, but didn't even grab her coat before marching out in the snow, determined to find her son. She hoped he was still okay, and that somehow she could find him in time. Billy no longer knew where he was, but had followed the voice out of town and into nearby woods. He had followed the voice's directions and was excited to see Lindsay and Tommy again. He could bring them home, and everyone would be happy. He had never walked through these woods before and couldn't believe the voice had led him to a house in a clearing in the middle. There were no other houses around, only the trees. The house was a small cabin made from logs, and he walked hesitantly up the stairs to the door of the house. He wasn't sure if he should do this and thought about turning around and getting his mom. He wasn't sure he knew the way home, though, and as he stood there contemplating, the door opened slowly in front of him. He peeked inside and couldn't believe what he saw. A fire immediately sprung up in the fireplace at the back wall, illuminating the room with a warm yellow glow. His eyes traveled around the room, and he lit up as he saw all the toys scattered around the room. Blocks, dolls, stuffed animals, and cars. His favorite! There were so many cars. Then he heard Lindsay's voice telling him, Come inside, Billy. It's time to play. He took a few steps into the room and didn't notice the door closing softly behind him. He looked up from the toys and saw Lindsay walking slowly toward him. At least it looked like Lindsay. She seemed a little pale, almost gray, including her clothes, and Billy wondered why he could almost see through her. Lindsay? Is it really you? He called out excitedly, his emotions a balance of bewilderment and relief. Lindsay opened her mouth to speak to him, but he heard her voice in his mind rather than his ears. "Hi, Billy. I'm so glad you made it. Now we can play forever. Would you like to meet the other children?" Billy heard another voice, which he thought sounded like Tommy. Another boy's voice then began speaking at the same time as Tommy, and then a girl's voice joined the chorus. Their voices blend together, but they were all saying different words at the same time, creating a sound that sounded like a buzzing beehive. Billy struggled to make up any of the words as Lindsay continued to step closer to him. More and more voices joined the raucous din, and the sound grew harsher and louder, culminating in an intense, roaring dissonance in his head. Billy put his hands over his ears in a futile attempt to block the deafening sound. He sunk to his knees and looked pleadingly into Lindsay's face for help as she moved closer until she was only a few feet in front of him. Lindsay looked down at Billy and smiled. Her smile grew until it transitioned into a mocking laughter. Billy was terrified. He felt his heart breaking as he watched who he thought was his best friend terrorizing him. Lindsay began to grow in size and twist into some sort of horrifying creature. "That's not Lindsay," he thought to himself. "I don't know what that is." The voices continued to grow louder as the creature now towered above him, its face contorted in a horrifying mask and its body writhing and slithering. The creature lowered its face toward Billy and its mouth stretched wide in a warped shape that looked like it planned to devour him. A single voice then cut through the cacophony to taunt him. "Scream for me, Billy. Scream for your life." Whisper made a final thrust toward Billy, coming within mere inches of his face. Face to face with the monster, Billy opened his mouth to scream, but the only sound he could manage was a faint whisper. "Please, stop." To Billy's surprise, the creature stopped, and its face moved from terror to a look of confusion. Whisper shrunk back down to Billy's size, maintaining its frightening form. The other voices in Billy's head slowly began to recede in his mind and finally fell silent until the only voice Billy heard was the voice of Whisper. "Why aren't you screaming like the other children? I need you to scream." The creature suddenly angled his head sharply and seemed distracted. Billy didn't know, but Whisper had sensed Billy's mother had followed his footsteps and now stood outside the house. Billy heard the faint, windy sound as Whisper spoke directly into Marcia's mind. "Why didn't he scream? I know he's terrified. He should have screamed out like all the other children. What's wrong with him?" Marcia trembled in fear for her son, but stubbornly found the courage to respond in a loud voice. "It's okay, Billy. Mommy's here." Then she addressed Whisper directly in a plea to save her son. "Let him go, Whisper. The doctor said he can't scream or yell or raise his voice at all. There's something wrong in his body." She made a final desperate plea. "Please, just let him go." Whisper turned its attention back to Billy and spoke brusquely. "You really can't scream like other children, can you?" Billy just shook his head no. And Billy sensed his disgust as Whisper stared disappointedly at him. They stared at each other for a moment, and Whisper finally broke the silence, growling, "Fine, but I'll be watching you and waiting. I feed on the screams of terrified children, and the next time you even raise your voice, I will devour you." Whisper gestured with his hand to the side, and Billy followed the hand to see Tommy and Lindsay had appeared and were now playing on the floor silently along with other children. The door creaked open behind Billy and Whisper pointed and commanded, "Go!" Billy slowly backed up a few steps and turned around and ran out the door toward his mom. As he made it past the door, he looked back over his shoulder but no longer saw Whisper. He looked over to Lindsay, still playing on the floor with Tommy. He stopped running and stared in astonishment as she turned her head toward him, made eye contact, and waved. Then the door slammed shut. And that was Whisper. Thanks for joining us at the Youngstown Public Library for Saturday Night Scares. Join us again next week. Until then, have a quiet, safe evening. And pay attention the next time you hear the whispering wind blowing. It may not be as harmless as you think.